right, good morning. Thanks for being in church this morning. Take your songbook, if you would, song number 121. Song number 121. Bring them in, and let's stand together. If we're able, as we sing all verses of 121. Bring them in, song number 121. Singing on verse number one, here we go, ready?
Hark, 'tis the shepherd's voice I hear, out in the desert, dark and drear, calling the sheep who've gone astray, far from the shepherd's fold away. Bring them in, bring them in. Bring them in, bring them in, bring the wandering ones to Jesus. Who'll go and help this shepherd kind? Help him the wandering ones to find. Who'll bring the lost ones to the fold, where they'll be sheltered from the cold? Bring them in, bring them in, bring them in from the fields of sin. Bring them in, bring them in, bring the wandering ones to Jesus. On the last, out in the desert, hear their cry, out on the mountains. Heart, 'tis the Master speaks to thee. Go find my sheep where'er they be. Bring them in, bring them in, bring them in from the fields of sin. Bring them in, bring them in, bring wandering ones to Jesus.
Let's open with a word of prayer as we begin the service this morning. Father, thank you for your goodness to us. Thank you for your love for us. And Lord, I thank you for the opportunity we have to be in church this morning. Speak to us, Lord, through thy word today. Lord, we're thankful for your faithfulness, as we'll sing in just a second. We sure do love you. Thank you for being faithful to us. Lord, may we be faithful to you. And Lord, we pray that if someone's here and has never trusted Christ as their Savior, that today would be the day they accepted Jesus, they accept Christ. And Lord, we are certainly glad to be in church this morning. We pray all these things in Jesus' name. Amen. You may be seated. Song number 26. It is our chorus of the month. Is that right? 28. Oh, I was going off the top of my head. I would have figured that out when I went to 26, and it wasn't it. It's 28. Great is thy faithfulness. We'll remain seated. We'll sing all three stanzas of Great is thy faithfulness. Sing unto the Lord this morning. Great is thy faithfulness. Song number 28. 28 in the songbook. Sing it on verse number 1. Ready?
Great is thy faithfulness, O God my Father. There is no shadow of turning with thee. Thou changest not thy compassions, they fail not. As thou hast been, thou forever wilt be. Great is thy faithfulness, great thy faithfulness. Morning by morning, new mercies I see. sing, pardon for sin and a peace that endureth. Thine own dear presence to cheer and to guide, strength for today and bright hope for tomorrow. Woman with 10,000 beside, great is thy faithfulness.
Aren't you glad about his faithfulness? And I'll tell you what, it does, you know, how many of you have had one of those days? I mean, it's just like, it's a day that just kind of just is like, boy, just kind of just blown up. We had one of those yesterday at our house, and but we're thankful for his faithfulness. We got up at 3 a.m. to come from Nashville to here, got to Phoenix at 7, got home by 11. By 12 o'clock, our air conditioner had gone out. And aren't you glad that we have someone that knows what they're doing when it comes to AC? And it pays, amen. A couple hours later, got that figured out. And then about 20, like literally 10 minutes before the prayer call, had no internet. So we had to, and I run the computer on that. And then on the prayer call, our Brother Harding wasn't able to be on. And so it was just one of those days. But aren't you glad we don't have to just get into the dumps in regards to bad things that happen and say, hey, great is his faithfulness. Amen. And so we're thankful to be in the house of the Lord this morning. And praise the Lord for that. The air conditioner is doing all it can today here. And so thanks for your patience in regarding these things. Just a couple quick announcements here. We're heading out tomorrow morning about 9 o'clock. For Big Bear, California, for our teen summer camp. Looking forward to a good week. And do be praying. I'll be preaching twice on Tuesday. And my wife will be giving a lesson, I think, on Thursday afternoon to the young people. And so if you can be praying in regards to that. And I'll be coming back for the Wednesday night prayer meeting. So we'll be here on Wednesday night for the Bible study and prayer meeting here this week. And so do be praying about these things, the trip there and back. It's just a couple hours, but yet prayer is always good. And so if we covet your prayers in regarding these things. We do have school coming up in just a few weeks, and so we'll be praying about that. We do have a back-to-school Sunday, and we kind of are just going to have a little bit of a theme. Maybe some people, some folks want to bring in maybe some supply. I'll have maybe some supply list. That'll be some things that we might need during the year, and looking forward to that. There is a Tuesday the 16th is our first day of school, and right now we have 9 students enrolled. And so we're thankful for what the Lord's going to do. Just be praying about these things coming up. And we're looking forward to a good year. And then, of course, we have other prayer requests. Folks are traveling. And so we want to make sure that we're mentioning those in prayer here in just a moment. And so we want to be praying for these requests. And I think that's all the announcements that I have at this moment. I feel like maybe I should have one or two more, but I didn't write them down, so we won't mention them, all right? Who has a prayer request? I do want to mention a couple things. Of course, I mentioned last night on the prayer call, Brother Nez and Mrs. Nez is out of the hospital, still dealing with a little bit of pain, but they're staying in Phoenix until Josiah is released from NICU. And I was able to talk to him yesterday. I tried to tried to meet up with him, but it just didn't work out as far as his schedule. And so do be praying for the Nezes, but as far as we know, everything's going well. They're still looking at his lungs and his eyes. Those are a couple things of concern that nothing has been, they're just kind of looking at, running some tests and so forth. And so he's still in the NICU. I hope to get some more information next week. And I did also mention that I got a call while we were in Tennessee from Mike Pratt, and that is Edith's grandson, who Edith had stayed with. And he had called to say that she was out of hospital, but was in hospice, and apparently he passed away that night. And so Edith is with the Lord, and certainly thankful for that. I just prayed you pray with for the family. I did stop by yesterday, didn't catch him at home. So just be praying for Mike and Stephanie. I know that was a prayer request of Edith's in regarding to their salvation, and just maybe the Lord would allow this opportunity to receive the gospel. And so just be praying for them, if you would, please. And I think that's well, a couple more. We have Miss Shirley's still in limbo as far as when you're going to have that surgery. Just that would come up here soon. And then a week from this Wednesday, is that right, Brother Mike? A week from this Wednesday, all set for his hip replacement. And so just be praying for him, if you would, please, for this surgery. Anybody else have a prayer request you want to mention this morning? And we'll go ahead and get those. Yes, ma'am. Miss Sylvia? Okay, September 6th. So we'll write that down. Has the back surgery there on the 6th of September. So be praying for Brother Jonathan, if you would, please. Yes, sir. Bob? Okay, so pray for a good friend of Bob's named Mike.
Mike Blakely.
Blakely. Okay, and has the virus back in Arkansas. Okay, so just praying for him. Just to bounce back, I think, right? You kind of hit him, you said. Okay. Sure. So be praying, if you would, for Mike here, a good friend of Bob, and living in Arkansas dealing with the virus. Who else has a prayer request? Yes. Okay, so the cancer has spread a little bit. Okay, so we'll be praying for Robert Fish, number 8, there, the spreading of the cancer. Has he started treatment? Okay, so he's doing the chemo pills. So just be praying for Robert Fisher and his health. Okay, number 8 on the list. Okay. All right. Anybody else with a prayer request this morning? Yes, sir, Brother Don. Yes. Okay. Okay. Pray for the Johnsons. They run the Donut Corral. Their grandson passed away in an ATV accident in Mississippi. So be praying for a family. There's a service on Tuesday. Is that going to be back in Mississippi? Be here. Okay, so just be praying for Johnson family. All right. Anybody else? Yes, sir. Okay. Yeah. So be praying for the family here. This sudden loss. Amen. Thank you. Anybody else with a prayer request this morning? All right. Let's go, Lord, in prayer for these. Yes, ma'am. Sure. Yes, we continue to be praying for our country, government officials, and thank you, Gigi, for that reminder. Appreciate that. And it is definitely something that we need to keep. And of course, do they do early voting? I'm pretty sure that early voting is on right now if you're voting. And I think it's this coming up in a couple weeks. So just certainly be praying for our country and also an opportunity to be a part of the voting here in the state of Arizona. Thank you. Anybody with unspoken requests, let's do those before we go to prayer. If you have unspoken, let's go ahead and get that, and we'll add these to the list this morning. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 16. Okay. All right, let's go to the Lord in prayer for these request this morning. Father, thank you for your goodness and the opportunity we have to pray to you. We do thank you for our nation. As mentioned ago, we're certainly, Lord, pause and realizing some of the decisions that are made that are against you, that are against your word. Certainly we're thankful for decisions that were made that are to reverse some things that have been wrong in our country. We're thankful for that. Certainly maybe it doesn't go far enough, but Lord, there's a start, and we're thankful. Lord, I pray that you'd be with our country and leadership, Lord, from the president on down to, Lord, our mayor here in Yuma. Lord, we pray for each one. Lord, we need wisdom. They need wisdom from you. We need wisdom from you. And Lord, I pray that you'd, Lord, grant us a stay of a wrath to come for, Lord, the things that we've done wrong. And would you give us mercy, Lord, so that we can continue to tell folks about you, the gospel of Christ. Lord, we think of these many requests that were mentioned. We think of Brother Jonathan going in for surgery on the 9th. Lord, I pray that you just be with him. Or on the 6th of September. Lord, I pray that you'd be with him and preparing for this. We think of Robert Fisher and his continued battle with cancer, Lord, and I pray that you just continue to be with him, give him the strength that he needs, heal his body. Lord, we think of Mike, a friend from Arkansas, Lord, that's dealing with the virus. Lord, I pray that you'd be with him, Lord, and also the Johnson family here in this sudden loss of life due to an ATV accident, Lord, and I just pray that you would just continue to be with the family here. May someone accept Christ as Savior because of this. We think of the Pratts. I pray that you'd be with them, Lord, and the homegoing of Edith. Lord, I pray that you just continue to be with this family. Lord, we think of the unspoken requests, 16 of them. I pray that you would meet each of these needs, Lord. And Lord, we are thankful that you give us the opportunity to pray. Lord, we think of, again, our missionaries. Think of Brother Harding, as he wasn't able to be on the call with us last night, but is ministering in many different cities throughout the year, Lord. And then during the week, they're in the capital our nation's capital, Lord, and I pray that you would just continue to, Lord, give him the strength that he needs, Lord, in a special way. Father, I pray that you would be with, Lord, other missionaries that we have that are both on the field, Lord, and also here stateside, perhaps on a furlough. I pray that you'd be with them, Lord, as well. Lord, we think of those that are traveling. We think of our traveling tomorrow to teen camp. Lord, we ask for safety and travel. And Lord, we ask that your will be done in the hearts of young people and adults as we're there. Lord, to give whatever you have for us to receive. And Lord, we thank you for this opportunity. Lord, I pray that you would bless all the service this morning and speak to us through your word. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. All right. Song number 86. And we'll sing this third song and we'll stand, have our offering. We will be ready for our offering. Guys will help us at the last of this. My Jesus, I love thee. Stand together as we sing all four stanzas. Song number 86 in your hymnal. My Jesus, I love thee. Song number 86. Ready? My Jesus, I love thee. I know thou art mine. For thee all the follies of sin I resign. My gracious Redeemer, my Savior art thou. If ever I love thee, my Jesus, 'tis now. I love thee because thou hast first loved me and purchased my pardon. I love thee for wearing the thorns on thy brow. If ever I love thee, my Jesus, 'tis now. I'll love thee in life, I will in death, and praise thee as long as thou lendest me breath, and sing when the death dew lies cold on my brow. If ever I love thee, my Jesus, on the last in mansions of glory. Ready? In mansions of glory and endless delight, I'll ever adore thee in heaven so bright. I'll sing with the glittering crown on my brow. If ever I love thee, my Jesus, 'tis now. Amen. Well, time for offering, and let's be faithful in our giving. And thank you for giving to the Lord, and certainly through the tithes and the offerings, and then, of course, the opportunities to give missions, and also to the Bible Literature Missionary Foundation. We're thankful for these times. And let's pray. Thank you, Father, for this opportunity we have to give back to you, and we're thankful for our offering, and thank you that, Lord, you allow us to be able to give. I pray that you bless the offering this morning and bless the gift and the giver. And again, we do thank you for this opportunity to give. And Lord, thank you for the word of God. We'll be able to open in just a second and be helped by your word. We thank you for these things. In Jesus' name, amen. You may be seated. Anchor holds. Grab your Bible now, if you would, please. And we're in Galatians, and we're continuing on in talking about the fruit of the Spirit. Galatians 5. Galatians chapter number 5. We've been looking at each part of the fruit of the Spirit. And may I remind us this morning that you cannot have the fruit of the Spirit without first trusting Jesus Christ as your Savior. And that's just a reminder for us. You can't have the fruit of the Spirit without the Holy Spirit, and you don't have the Holy Spirit without having Christ Himself and trusting Him as your Savior. And when you try to incorporate these things without the Holy Spirit, you'll end up with the works of the flesh. And so those are the things that we see in verses 17, 18, 19, 20, and 21. And so now it doesn't say that the Christian is not exempt from the works of the flesh. The Christian can, unfortunately, live a life of in the flesh, even though being saved. But it's not a good thing. It's not a good thing to continue. We look at verse number 22 and 23. Just a reminder here, and we'll go into the third part that we see here, the fruit of the Spirit. Notice what the Bible says, verse 22. And so Galatians chapter number 5, verse number 22. But the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, long-suffering, gentleness, goodness, faith, meekness, temperance. Against such there is no law. We're going to talk today about the third one mentioned this morning. We've talked about love. We've talked about joy. And today we're going to talk about peace. Thank you, Father, for this time and the Word of God. Speak to us for these next few moments for your name's sake. We love you and we thank you for what you've given us. We pray all these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Part of, I mentioned this in the last hour, part of the trip that was great, that I felt like was awesome, was all of it. And, on Friday, now get this, now our bodies were a little bit tired. We were going around a long table collating scriptures, and we were on our feet, taking breaks and stuff, lunch and so forth, but on your feet a lot, moving back and forth and collating scripture and so forth. And on Friday, right before closing time, when the employees, and they have between 10 and 12 employees that's there working on different parts of the publishing and the printing of the Bibles and so forth. And then they could always use groups and things to help to fill in different areas and to collate and so forth. But the last thing that we did was Brother Shannon Lamont took us. We went into the hallway. It's kind of connecting the offices to the actual Bible barn itself. And all along that one wall, there's tables. And there's facsimiles of all the different English Bibles that have come up until the King James and all the way back. You got the Tyndale Bible, the Great Bible, and they're all facsimiles, like it's the real thing, and it's just a, you know, obviously a copy. And we went through and did a presentation for about an hour and 15 minutes. Kind of similar like what we have when we put out those little brochures for the English Bible. He gave the history of the English Bible going back from to the Hebrew and the Greek and how it collated all together and how God preserved his word all the way up until 1611 and the historical things that happened during that time to get us our Bible. Unbelievable. And just a reminder, just hearing it once again, you can never hear that enough. And just to be reminded how God preserved and gave us is his word. And that's why it's so important that we stand for the word of God. And we love it and we read it. And don't say you love the word of God if you don't read it. And if you're not, living your life by it. And so today we're going to talk about peace. And is that not a word that the world longs for? We're praying for peace. The world is wanting peace in Ukraine because of the things that are going on there. And certainly not just peace, but here they're looking for this. They're looking for peace of mind. Peace of mind. Maybe a wording that's used that the world longs for is that of an inner peace. Or what we hear that will happen at the Great Tribulation is that of a world peace, where the Antichrist will come and offer peace and make a peace treaty. And there will be 3.5 years of peace, and then there will be war after that. But that's what everyone's looking for. We're looking for peace. Some seek peace in different things. They seek it perhaps in bottles. They seek it in pills. They seek it in human relationships. They seek it in hobbies. They seek peace in activities. They seek peace in and vacations, but the more, unfortunately, it is sought after, the less is found. In the Old Testament, the word shalom is a word used for peace, and that means, it means a desire or prayer that all is well with you. In the New Testament, the word peace is, definition is to bind together. And the message simply this morning is this, and we're going to look at two portions of Scripture to help us to see how we can have peace. Is peace is not just merely the absence of war. Peace is not merely the absence of war, but peace is in the presence of Jesus Christ. Peace is not an absence of war. Peace is not a refraining from a conflict. Peace is the presence of the Lord. Peace is harmony and oneness with God's purpose. And what happens is that as we look to other things, as we look to other things to get us to the place where we believe that if we find this, we will have peace. What we're doing is we're running from the one who gives the peace, and that is Jesus Christ. I want you to look at an Old Testament account of this in Jonah chapter number 1. Please go back to the book of Jonah in chapter number 1, please. Jonah in chapter number 1. You will not find peace in anything else other than the Lord. And when we say that, it's all-encompassing. It's not just the Lord, it's His Word. It would be His church. It would be His will all of those things encompass the Lord. So when we say, the peace is found in the Lord, it's not your definition, it's His definition. Everything that has to do with the Lord is part of the Lord. His word, His will, His desire for your life, your relationship with Him, all of these are included. I'm afraid that sometimes even in today's time in which we live, we become our own dictionaries. You know what I mean by that? We have words and we define what the definitions of the words are. And the definition of a word that you might think is a definition is not the same of me. And boy, when we're defining our own definition of words, then basically we're doing what we feel is right for ourselves. And that is definitely contrary to the Word of God. Anytime we see where the Bible says amended right, that which is right in their own eyes, it didn't always end up to be good. Does that make sense? And so we want to make sure that if we're doing right, it's going to be by God's word and not our word. And so as we look at peace, as we define what peace is, it's not obtaining anything else other than the presence of the Lord Jesus Christ. Being in tune with Him brings peace. You don't have to worry about anything. If you're worrying about something, it's because you're thinking and about something that perhaps is other than Jesus Christ. Hey, folks, listen. When you read Revelation, guess what happens? Jesus wins. Amen? Aren't you glad about that? Do you believe it this morning? Okay, so guess what? Whatever happens between now and then, good or bad, it's not going to change what the Scripture said in the fact that Jesus wins. Satan loses. I'm not trying to spread a rumor here, okay? This is biblical fact. Jesus wins, Satan loses. Now, that's not the case right now. Jesus is winning now, yes. But Satan feels like he's winning here on earth. And he's trying to do everything he can to mess things up and to get Christians discouraged and all of these different things. But he's trying to give a false peace. A false peace. Anything that the Lord can give truly, Satan can give artificially. Anything that God can give truly, God gives salvation truly. For whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. For God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in Him should not perish, but have everlasting life. What God can give absolutely, Satan gives artificially. There are people that believe that because they live a good life, they can go to heaven. There are people that believe because of chance and circumstance they can go to heaven. They believe that maybe in the next life they'll be able to have a better life, and in the next life they'll have a better life, and the next life they'll have a better life. There are so many different ways to believe in this world that one would go to heaven, but if it's absence of Jesus, if it doesn't have Christ and Him alone as the way to heaven, then it's an artificial way. And listen, this is the Bible speaking. This is the Word of God. And so there's many people that have an artificial peace about afterlife, about heaven, when guess what? If they don't trust Christ, they're going to wake up and they're going to have a rude awakening. And it's not going to be where they thought, because it was artificial. And so when we think about peace, we want to have the real thing. We don't want to have just an artificial peace. We don't want to have something that will just last for a little bit. We want something that will last forever. And what is going to last forever is the Lord and His presence in our life. We see here in Jonah chapter number 1 that peace comes when you just simply obey Christ and obey His will. Notice in verse number 1, now the word of the Lord came unto Jonah, the son of Amittai, saying, arise, go to Nineveh, that great city, and cry against it, for their wickedness is come up before me. Pretty cut and dry, right? The word of the Lord comes to the prophet of God, the one who has been called to be a part of proclaiming the gospel, to proclaiming the word of God to the people. And the word of the Lord came to Jonah, and it said, I want you to go, I want you to get up, I want you to take a missions trip to Nineveh, because they need the gospel of Christ. They need the message. They need to repent of what they're doing. They need to know who I am. And so in verse number 2 it says, arise, go to Nineveh, that great city, and cry against it, for their wickedness is come up before me. Now, would there be peace if Jonah would have obeyed the command of God? Is there peace in obeying the command of God? Absolutely. There is peace. You might not understand what God wants you to do, but when you make a decision to follow after the Lord, and when you make a decision by faith, and you make a decision, you will know that this isn't about me, it's about God. But what did Jonah do? Jonah made it about him, right? Jonah made it about him. And boy, those Ninevites, should they really receive the message from the gospel? I mean, they're wicked people. Whatever went on in Jonah's head, whatever decision-making that Jonah was thinking at the time, it wasn't involved in perfect peace. If God says to do it, we do it. Is that right? That is the formula that God wants us to have. When God gives us something, when God tells us to do something, what should we do? We should do it. And so to me, again, hindsight's always 20/20, but to me, there shouldn't be a verse 3 of Jonah chapter 1 other than Jonah went, people got saved because he obeyed the Lord. But always what happens is that when we try to find peace some other way, and especially, get this now, especially when God has already revealed the perfect way for peace. The perfect way for peace was to Jonah to get however he was going to get there, whether it was by camel, by land, or by sea, however he was going to get there, Jonah should have made plans to go straight to Nineveh. Because that's where God said, listen, this is where you're going to have peace. But what happened? Look at verse number 3. You know it. Jonah 1. Again, we're trying to have peace. And the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace. But Jonah rose up to flee into Tarshish. Notice this now. From the presence of the Lord. So if he's running from the presence of the Lord, is his peace going to be permanent or is it going to be artificial? Is it going to be all lasting or is it going to be artificial? Is it going to be just for a season? Boy, that first day on the boat going to Tarshish, nothing happened. The second day, nothing happened. The third day, nothing happened. I don't know how long he was out there, but guess what? Something was going to happen. And guess what? It didn't even bother Jonah. He was in the bottom of the boat sleeping. I'm fast forwarding. But it wasn't a pure, lasting peace. It wasn't a harmony and a oneness with God's purpose. God's purpose for Jonah was to go to Nineveh. Wasn't it? Jonah's purpose was not for that the word of the Lord would get to Nineveh. He wanted to do something else. And so he had an artificial peace for a while, in so much that he could sleep like a baby in the middle of the storm when everybody else is like, you know, going beside themselves saying, there's a storm. What's going on? Hey, listen, we got to make some accounting here and go to everyone's God to find out if they're okay. And they finally got to Jonah, and Jonah said, I'm not okay. I'm kind of running. Right? I'm taking the assumption that everyone knows the story of Jonah. The idea is that he was running from the presence of the Lord. He was searching for his own peace that would only last so long because it wasn't of God. It wasn't a harmony and a oneness with God's purpose. It wasn't necessarily in the presence of the Lord. He was trying to go away from the presence of the Lord. Verse 4, the Lord sends out a great wind in the sea, and there was a great tempest in the midst of the sea, so the ship was like to be broken. Then the mariners were afraid and cried every man unto his God and cast forth the wares that were in the ship into the sea to lighten it of them. But Jonah was gone down to the sides of the ship, and he lay and was fast asleep. So the shipmaster came to him and said unto him, what meanest thou? O sleeper, arise, call upon thy God, if so be that God will think upon us that we perish not. Verse number 9, and he said unto them, I am a Hebrew, and I fear the Lord, the God of heaven, which hath made the sea and the dry land. And then the men were exceedingly afraid, and said unto them, why hast thou done this? For the men knew that he had fled from the presence of the Lord, because he had told them. Ladies and gentlemen, this is not the peace from God that he's receiving. Now, you might say, well, does that mean, Pastor, that every storm I go through, it's because I'm not at peace with God? No, this is why you go back to your own accounting with the Scriptures to find out if sometimes it's just a Job experience. Because God said so. But we know this is twice because of the fact that, guess what? He's not going to have a true peace. Why? Because he's running from the presence of the Lord. Even in the midst of the presence of the Lord, Job said, hey, I'm not going to sin or charge God foolishly. And so we're not saying that every storm and every wind that comes and every tempest that comes your way, it's because you're out of God's will and you're seeking an artificial peace. That is not what the Bible gives us the understanding in a pattern of Scripture. But if you are out of God's will and you are running from Him, you will definitely 100% at some point have an artificial peace. You'll have an artificial peace. It won't be lasting. We got to follow Him. We got to follow His Word. We got to follow what He has us to do. And that's exactly what we see here. And so no peace has come in Jonah because he's going away from the presence of the Lord. Look, if you would, now at Acts chapter number 26. Acts 26. Here's a New Testament. Example, and there's others, but because of time, we're only going to look at this one. Part of Paul's ministry in the latter part of his ministry was that he went to dignitaries, he went to the kings. He was a freeborn Roman citizen, and so that gave him some extra special opportunities that not all Hebrews had. And he is able to stand before these kings, and he's able to give his testimony. And here in Acts chapter number 26, he is standing before King Agrippa, and he's going to give his testimony, and he's going to talk about how he received Christ as a Savior. Now, we know this, that Paul talks about the fact that he went through some shipwrecks. He goes through times of being beaten. He went through times of perilous times, being thrown in the prison. You go to Acts chapter number 16, and you'll find that he's in the prison there in Philippi. Philippian jailer's there. And just a lot of things happened to Paul. Would you not agree that a lot of things, bad things, if we would, sometimes there was a couple times he was stoned and left for dead. But the question that I want you to answer in regards to the scripture was, did Paul at this moment have the peace that comes from the presence of God? The answer would be yes. We can see that. It is definitely not anything but the truth to know that God was with the Apostle Paul. I mean, he even put all these, certainly allowed him to pen all these Pauline epistles that we see in the New Testament. And Paul just thanking God, even in chains. I don't know if I'd be praising God if I was in jail. Not because, and because I didn't do anything wrong. But the truth is that part of his ministry was here at this time, in the latter part of Acts, he was able to stand before Caesar. He was standing before Agrippa. And so as we look here, we see, though, that Paul not always had the presence of God, didn't always have that peace. Look at verse number 1. Acts 26, verse number 1. Then Agrippa said unto Paul, thou art permitted to speak for thyself. He didn't know what he was getting into, huh? Because Paul was about ready to give him the gospel message. Then Paul stretched forth the hand and answered for himself. I think myself happy, King Agrippa, because I shall answer for myself this day before thee, touching all the things whereof I am accused of the Jews, especially, verse 3, because I know thee to be an expert in all customs and questions among which are among the Jews. Wherefore I beseech thee to hear me patiently. My manner of life from my youth, which was at the first among mine own nation at Jerusalem, know all the Jews, which knew me from the beginning, if they would testify that after the most straitest sect of our religion, I lived a Pharisee. And now I stand and am judged for the hope and of the promise made of God unto our fathers, unto which promise are 12 tribes, instantly serving God day and night, hope to come, for which hope's sake, King Agrippa, I am accused of the Jews. Verse number 8. Why should it be thought a thing incredible with you that God should rise from the dead? I verily, though, verily thought with myself that I ought to do many things contrary to the name of Jesus of Nazareth, which thing I also did in Jerusalem, and many of the saints did I shut up in prison, having received authority from the chief priests. And when they were put to death, I gave my voice against them. So now let's pause for a second. He's talking about everything he did before he got saved. And I ask you this question, very, very simple answer. Did Saul, who was Paul afterwards, but did Saul at this time have the perfect Holy Spirit of peace in his life? As he's a Pharisee, as he's taking these Christians, as he's testifying against them, and as he's killing them. Is that peace artificial, or is it everlasting? It's artificial, right? He feels like what he's doing is right, and he has an artificial peace in that. Notice what it says in verse number 11, and I punished them oft in every synagogue, and compelled them to blaspheme, and being exceedingly mad against them, I persecuted them even unto strange cities. Whereupon, as I went to Damascus with authority and commissioning from the chief priest. Now again, is he obtaining what would be a godly fruit of the Spirit peace in his life at this moment? Before seeing Christ on the Damascus Road, did he have the peace of the presence of God? The answer is no. But did he feel like he had a peace? Hey, he was fine in what he was doing. He was fine in what he was acting. I want you to notice what he says in verse number 13. At midday, O king, I saw in the way a light from heaven above the brightness of the sun shining round about me and them which journeyed with me. And when we were all fallen to the earth, I heard a voice speaking unto me and saying in the Hebrew tongue, Saul, Saul, why persecutest thou me? Notice this next phrase. It is hard for thee to kick against the pricks. And I said, who art thou, Lord? And he said, I am Jesus, whom thou persecutest. That phrase there, that last phrase, gives us an insight on the fact that what he was doing was an artificial peace. Justice, come here a second. When God is in agreement with what you're doing, there is a perfect peace that comes. Does that make sense? Because you're in the presence of the Lord. And just like in a father-son relationship, there, as long as when the son's doing what he's supposed to, the father's happy. Now, this is just an example, because the picture between God the Father and us, God is always right, okay? And a lot of times in this realm, sometimes that is wrong, but sometimes that is right. And sometimes children are wrong, but sometimes children are right. And so that balance comes into play, and we certainly understand that. But when it comes to God and it comes to us, when we're doing everything that God wants us to do and we're living the life that He wants us to live, there is what's called the spirit, the peace, a true peace. And it's exemplified there in Galatians chapter 5, love, joy, peace. But if, and we'll use justice here as Saul was doing some things that was egregious to the Lord. I mean, it wasn't just so long before that Christ died for the sins of the world. Christ died for the salvation of these Christians, and now Christians are getting saved. And Peter's up there preaching in Jerusalem, and 3,000 people get saved. And then next thing you know, 5,000 people get saved. And people are trusting Christ, and they're receiving the gospel of God, the death, burial, and the resurrection of Christ. And here comes somebody from the Pharisee side, which we know, we don't have to go into a long dissertation for you to understand what Jesus thought of the Pharisees, right? I mean, do we know, we understand what Jesus thought of the Pharisees? And he wasn't mad at them. They were just not trusting in him. They were trusting in the law. And so here's Saul. And so this is Saul here. And Saul's over here doing this. And I turn him so his back is turned. And this is what God is saying. God's saying, I'm trying to get your attention. I'm trying to get your attention, Saul. And that's exactly, without going into grave detail, that's exactly what that term is this. Hey, you're kicking against, hey, you're resisting, I'm trying to get your attention. Saul, I'm trying to get your attention. Saul, what you're doing isn't right. I'm trying to get your attention. Do you understand when we go out and we tell someone about Christ and we maybe do something as simple as just tell someone about, give someone a gospel tract or give them the testimony of how we got saved. Do you know all that is doing is that's just fulfilling what's going on here? No, stay here, man. Sorry. I wasn't clear. It's simply this. God is not willing that any should perish, by the way. But what's the last part of the verse? But that all should come to repentance. How do all come to repentance? God through the Holy Spirit is trying to get their attention. Do you remember when God got your attention? Do you remember when you yielded to Christ? Do you remember that day? When you accepted Christ as your Savior, you fulfilled what God was already trying to do, what He's been trying to do for all men. He's been trying to get everyone's attention. Now, why doesn't everybody get saved? Because they have the opportunity to resist that temptation, or resist the calling of God, the wooing of the Holy Spirit. They have the opportunity to resist the Holy Spirit. They have that opportunity to say, no, 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 I'm not going to listen. But Saul didn't do that. God said, you're resisting me. And what was the first words out of his mouth? What must I do? Lord, what do I need to do? It was a submission of, okay, if I was resisting before, I'm not resisting again. Thank you, sir. Appreciate it. You can be seated. Saul was operating under a false, artificial peace. And the reason why he was doing that is because he wasn't saved. He received once he received Christ and was doing his will, oh boy, it was a wonderful life of being in the presence of God and having the peace from the Spirit. What does he say in Ephesians? And grieve not the Holy Spirit of God, whereby ye are sealed till the day of redemption. And let all bitterness and wrath and anger and clamor and evil speaking be put away from you with all malice. And be ye kind one to another, tenderhearted, forgiving one another, even as God for Christ's sake hath forgiven you. Listen, if we can live under the life of having that peace, and it's not artificial. I hate to say this, but churches today are filled with people who are living in artificial peace. Either they're A, never trusted Christ as their Savior, or B, they're running from God's will in their life. Both of them show an artificial peace. You can't have the pure peace of the presence of God without being saved. And you can't have the pure presence of God and be running from it. Running from His will. Running from what He wants you to do. Running from simply listening to Him. God gave the word to Jonah. Jonah said, I don't think so. But aren't you glad when you go to chapter number 2 of Jonah? I think it is. I'm going to go back there. Might be chapter 3. I should have saved it. I should have put a little bookmark in there, and I didn't. In Jonah, in chapter number 3, and verse number 1. If you ever find yourself, running, you're saved. I mean, he was a prophet of God. You can't be a prophet of God and lost, okay? So he's a prophet from God, Jonah is. He is what we would call a pastor in today's realm. A leader giving the words of God. And he's been given the word of God in verse number 1 of chapter number 1. And he says no. He doesn't say no with his mouth. He says no with his actions. I'm not going to take the word of God to Nineveh. And God humbly changes his mind. And he humbly says, okay. After 3 days in the belly of a whale, a great fish. And then what's the word of the Lord say? In chapter 3, verse 1, look at it and we'll close. And the word of the Lord came unto Jonah the second time, saying, same message, arise, go unto Nineveh, that great city, and preach unto it the preaching that I bid thee. And Jonah arose and went to Nineveh according to the word of the Lord. Now, we could go on and do more in regards to analyzing the message to know that he had a bad attitude. We know that. Can I just say this? When you do what God says to do, you'll get the results that God wants you to get. They got saved. Nineveh got saved. The king goes in the sackcloth and ashes and he repents. The whole people repent. The whole nation repents. Listen, peace comes when we're in the presence of the Lord. And artificial peace is here for two reasons. One is if you think you're doing okay in regarding to your life. Listen, you know riches really puts a damper on eternal peace with God. Riches does, because you feel like, I don't need anything. I don't need God. I got everything I need. I got $100 million in the bank. Why do I need God? Well, you need him whether you've got $1 in the bank or $100 million. You need God. But that's an artificial peace. An artificial peace will be changed to an eternal peace if you accept Christ as your Savior. And then for the Christian, you can have an artificial peace if you're running from God and doing your own thing. There'll be time, it'll feel good for a while. And I don't know how long that while is. Could be a few days, it could be years, it could be decades. The sin of Saul to the Gibeonites wasn't even rectified until the next generation. But the honest, simple truth is that you can have an artificial peace if you're running from the Lord, from the presence of the Lord. And so this morning, based on the message, we can either account ourselves and say, you know what, I need to trust Christ. Or, hey, I need to account myself to make sure that the peace that I have is from the Lord because I'm following Him. And I'm not going to worry about the future. I'm not going to worry about. I'm just going to simply take thy word as a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. And so every step that I make, it's going to be because I'm looking through the eyes of the Lord and His word to make that step. And you'll turn around. You'll be able to find out, wow, I've been walking in a straight line because you're following His word. And it's not artificial. But I'll tell you what, it's hard to decipher between real and artificial. But only you know if you're following the Lord or if you're running from it. Father, I pray that you'd help us this morning. Thank you for the Word of God. And Lord, I pray that every one of us would desire to have the fruit of the Spirit, peace. And may it not be artificial. May it not be because we think we're doing right and we think that our way to heaven is the best way and it's what we learned as a kid. And so we're just going to follow through with it. We're not going to submit ourselves to the word of the Lord. If there's someone here this morning that's never trusted Christ as their Savior, I pray that today would be the day that they make that decision to trust Christ. Please. Lord, I know I'm saved not because of my past, what family I grew up in, what churches I went to, what Bible college I went to. None of that. It's because I accepted Jesus Christ as my Savior. And then I trusted Christ and then went, of course, through believer's baptism and got involved in a church. Lord, nothing's been perfect throughout the years, but Lord, I've been trying as best I can to follow you. And Father, I pray that you'd help us, Lord, today, that if someone here is running from you, in other words, you told them what to do, and they're deciding not to do it, Lord, that's going to be an artificial peace. And Father, I pray that before the whale comes and that experience, would we kind of get back on track to follow you, to know that the perfect peace comes from following you. It's not artificial. It's not fake. It's real. Father, I pray that you bless and help us now during this invitation time, we pray. Our heads are bowed, eyes are closed. In just a moment, we're going to have an invitation time. We'll stand. There'll be an opportunity for you to come. And whatever you need to respond to, will you respond? Father, bless this invitation, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Heads are bowed, eyes are closed. Let's all stand, please. Time for an invitation. Time for an opportunity to respond to what the Lord has done in your heart. Do you have peace? Is it artificial or is it real? How can you decipher? The Lord will allow this opportunity, this time, for you to talk to Him. Thank you, Lord Jesus, for your word. And I pray that we would identify, Lord, and make sure and continue to be in your presence, Lord, that we can have the peace from the fruit of the Spirit. We thank you for these things and thank you for your word. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you for being here this morning. God bless you. TJ is going to come. He's going to lead us in our closing song, 28, the chorus, Great is Thy Faithfulness. And then if you can get a microphone to Brother Don Reimer, if you have that there. Do you have one? If we can get that there so that he can close the service in prayer. So if we can get that there. And we're singing the chorus, Great is Thy Faithfulness. It's song number 28. Thank you for being here this morning, folks. Thanks for the prayers this week and this past week. And we'll This is good just to kind of keep us in your prayers because we're going to be on traveling this week as well. And so we're going to sing this song. Brother Reimer will close us in prayer, and then we'll be dismissed. God bless you.
The chorus of page number 28, Great is Thy Faithfulness.
Great is Thy Faithfulness, great.
Heavenly Father, we come to you this morning again. We thank you for the privilege of hearing your word explained to us and given to us. We thank you for the message of this morning, and we ask that we might take these words home with us today, and that we might meditate on those, and we ask for your peace in each one of our lives. We thank you so much for your word. We ask you to go with us, then bring us back again later this evening. We thank you for your love and your care. Amen.